in helplessness, in hopelessness, because you do not know. Even when they say, yes, put me on the list, or you're put on the list and you go for peacekeeping, you are not sure whether you'll also come back alive. That in itself puts you in a situation that is life-threatening. When the family also learns that their own has gone to war, has gone for a peacekeeping mission, even when it is called peacekeeping mission, they know too well, there is a time I will call my husband, I might not reach him. There is a time I have issues at home, I have to sort them out because I cannot reach him. If it's the children, the same thing. Sometimes they ask, when is daddy coming? My experience with the KDF soldiers, there are some that served for 18 months. We handled them recently in March 2018, just recently. And thank you for the volunteers that are in here that served them with me. And they were actually saying, for 18 months, maybe you left your wife pregnant. And when you come back, you're not sure. Sometimes they would tell me, I'm not sure whether that child, I'll feel I can even bond with them. And it's very true, some of them feel like those children are their strangers. So what exactly happens? There are four ways that our peacekeepers respond when they have developed PTSD. And one of them, you have heard them sharing, is called re-experiencing, the flashbacks. Somebody has gone to war in Somalia, for example, in Sierra Leone, they come back home, but they have not left the battlefield, mentally and spiritually. They are away physically, and that is why our senior sergeant, Shikuku here, has shared. You go, you have the flashbacks in form of nightmares, you know, bad dreams. You are screaming that you are being, you know, pursued. Some dream with weird animals. It means your mind has been destabilized. You are not yourself anymore. And the worst thing that happens when they have the re-experience is when it happens sometimes in public. Somebody just sees, for example, the Al-Shabaab coming to you, and they are not there. It's only in the mind. They haven't gone yet, but you're back home. And so you're ordering everybody to take cover, only to find you're the only one who has taken cover. The rest are just staring at you. What happens next? You don't even want to go to public places. You can go to the next way of responding, which is equally disastrous, avoidance. You deny that was me doing that. You deny this could not be happening to me. You start feeling like you're two people in one person. And so you start getting scared of your own self. And you can imagine if you are a father, you are a husband, your family is expecting, you know, like they're so expectant when you come back from the mission. True? And here you're so scared of yourself, you can't even share yourself with the family. That sometimes for the sole reason you're working, it's because of these people. So there can be that avoidance. Some don't even want to talk about, they don't want to hear the mention of the peacekeeping zone where they were deployed. They don't want to hear people sharing about that. Because the minute they do, those are triggers now for the nightmares, flashbacks. Some of them actually believe they are mad. PTSD is that serious. Because when you are having those flashbacks and you behave like you're not in sync with others, you might start now believing, I am now like those mental cases in a mental hospital. But the truth is, you suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder that was not addressed in good time. You might also have other people in trying to avoid. Like for example, if I am a husband and my wife keeps saying, you know, I can't sleep because of you. And so you are asking now, do I take a separate room and leave her alone? And when I do, what message am I sending to my children? So you might find some of them actually going out of their own family homes. And for you also to deal with all this under avoidance, you find that some of them will bury themselves in alcohol and drugs. And then you're asking, you know, people have that mentality that military soldiers or personnel, they like drinking. And some even say it is offered for free. The things they encounter, some of them, if they don't understand what it is, they will only want to fight it using drugs or what we call self-medication. You will find others totally separating from their families or even divorcing, only to go into another family and you experience the same thing. Yet it's because they do not understand. There's this one way of responding that is equally damaging. It is called hypervigilance or hyperarousal. This is where the soldier who is always alert in the war zone comes back from the war zone and continues to be alert. In fact, one case in experience, and I'm glad Edward is here, we had in Kenya Military Academy, we found that one of the soldiers had refused totally to hand over the gun. And he was saying, "Counselor, please go and tell Major General to allow me just to go home with this gun. Would you allow him?" But why did he want to go home with the gun? In that state of hypervigilance, feeling always threatened, pursued by Al-Shabaab, he wanted also to be guarded for self-defense. But what is the danger of carrying this weapon with him at home? Of course, nobody would be allowed. But if he's not allowed that gun and if he's not held, he's going to carry another weapon. And in that hyper-arousal, sometimes there's no moment of thinking. They just react. So you hear cases of domestic violence, high level of irritability. Sorry to mention this, you have seen lately on television. You have seen it, you know, where one really attacked his own child. Some also tell me, I think when I go to that home and I hear they have mismanaged the funds that, you know, I've spent my life like in Somalia. You know, I have risked my life. Now to Atakufa, somebody will die. And they are in that state of paranoia. These are the soldiers, even when they are at home, because they were so used to being alert in the war zone, they have not been put to a situation that they can calm down. I'm looking at the retired officers here, peacekeepers. A lot has gone, you know, under, you know, the bridge water, under the bridge, you would say. But they are those that we receive immediately. You look at the eyes, they are like for the little baby born of yesterday or one day. That opens the eyes and they don't close. I hope you guys look at those kids that are just born. Because they are always alert. Now, this father comes back home. And it's the same way you're looking at your children and your wife. And they're telling you, hey, he's always suspecting you're doing something wrong. He himself is not aware, but the family is aware. And because he's been given messages that he has not internalized, again, there is conflict. There is a lot that he could talk about the hyper-arousal. But the worst of it is when the body can never relax. And so they will use self-medication, a lot of alcohol, a lot of drugs. Some of them who are Christians, holier than thou, they can go extreme to having extramarital relationships, thinking this is going to ease off what they are going through. And at the end of the day, what do we have? Broken families. At the end of the day, what do we have? Escalated domestic violence. And at the end of the day, we might have half of them developing panic attacks, some of them cardiac arrest that can actually make you die, some of them hypertensive, and others diabetes. What we call stress-related or lifestyle diseases. It may not be a lifestyle of choice, like for those who don't have a healthy diet and they develop diabetes, but for those people, for our peacekeepers. It was, they went out to make peace or keep peace, and they came back and lost peace. So at the end of the day, you will find them in response number 4, recurrent negative thoughts and emotions. These negative thoughts, some of them ask, why did I even go? Why did I even join the military? A while ago in Kenya, before 2011, we had so many of our young people desiring to join the military. Right now, I can tell you if they are joining, some of them is out of desperation. The name Al-Shabaab, you also keep hearing, talks about the youth. So today, you will find some peacekeepers asking, did my business just end with peacekeeping? They do not know they suffered PTSD. Because if you went in knowingly that I've gone to keep peace, and then you came out and you were helped to stabilize and reintegrate, maybe you wouldn't have the negative thoughts. You would feel like that hero that served the world or served your nation. What about emotions? Some of them, as you have heard, if you go to a country that is torn with war, children are dying, women are being raped, a lot of evil against human rights is happening.